Thank you all for joining us. And as Jaideep mentioned, Mr. Mahansaria needs no introduction. But I just thought that there might be a few milestones in his journey so far that maybe I could highlight. Everyone knows that Alliance Tyre Group, when it was sold, it was valued at about $1.2 billion when it was sold to Yokohama Rubber. But before that, Mr. Mahansaria has actually worked with two private equity firms, Warburg and KKR, and I'm hoping that he'll draw on his experience for the audience here today. He was also instrumental in two overseas acquisitions during ATG. And that's also something that, you know, because he seems to, he has a lot of buy and build strategy, and this is something that we hope to discuss today. So thank you so much, sir.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. This is your third innings. Can you tell us a bit about your three businesses and the different strategies that you had and the kind of market opportunity that you saw?
Yeah. So generally, you know, we've tried to build businesses around our core belief that India is very well positioned to be a manufacturing hub, not just for India, but for the global markets. So that's been the central theme that we've tried to build upon in all our ventures. And having had the opportunity to start in the tyre industry, that's where we've built all the three ventures, because I feel it's easier to build a venture within an industry you know and understand and have gained expertise in rather than trying something new. So I'd say that these are the two core themes around which we've tried to build our ventures. And then in different ways, we've tried to differentiate each venture from the other one.
Can you tell us a little bit about that differentiation?
Sure. So I would say that, Balkrishna was a lot about learning about how to build a global business. And those days, it was a very different India and a very different world, not as connected as today. And, back in those days, we still used fax machines and not emails and WhatsApp and all of that. So it was a very different environment. India was itself at a different point in its journey. Companies had just started globalizing. So it was very much about a learning phase. And very much centered about using the Indian manufacturing cost advantage and make cheap and use price as an advantage to gain market share. That was an entirely organic build out. I think the next time round, we used build and buy strategy, combining both elements. So we started off buying a business in Israel to access the brand, the technology, the front end, and then complemented it with the manufacturing capabilities and resources available in India. We went on to do another acquisition in the US, again to build the front end. So it was, a much more evolved strategy in terms of using capital and using acquisition opportunities to turbocharge growth while still leveraging India's cost competences. The third time round, our strategy is still very much a work in progress. But again, what is important for us is trying to figure out an element of that will differentiate us in global markets, because I think that's very important.
Right. I know you can't talk about your third venture a whole lot, but I just want to unpack a bit about what you said about ATG.
Yeah.
That you've worked with two PE firms and that you acquired overseas.
That's right.
Can you give us a experience on how that helped you scale the business? Because a lot of us are looking at ways to scale our businesses.
So I think, in most businesses, the key challenge is getting market access and getting the go-to-market strategy right. And that was what was what we were hoping to solve when we did the acquisition of Alliance Tyre in Israel. Now, this is a company that had been in existence at that point in time for over 50 years, was very well respected in the markets, had a large network of customers on a global basis, had global brand and product library and so many of the building blocks. And we felt that by acquiring that business, we would turbocharge our growth, because it would save us the time required to build that ground up, which is, you know, in any business, the most challenging part. And I think it was very heartening that that strategy played out the way we anticipated it to play out. When we bought Alliance in Israel, it was about $150 million business. And then we were able to complement that with the Indian manufacturing subsequent acquisitions. And in under 10 years, we were able to reach revenues of $600 million, which had we started completely greenfield would have been a longer journey for us.
Okay. And capital was a differentiator at that point.
Yeah, I would say that we, you know, to do an acquisition of that size and scale, we did need access to capital. And I think we were able to partner with Warburg at that time, and they were, willing to provide us the capital that helped us execute the strategy. So I think, your capital needs are a function of the business plans and opportunities and not vice versa.
Can you give us some sense of how it was working with PE firms? Because you'd given up control of your venture at that point.
So look, I think we had a very successful and enjoyable partnership with both the funds we worked with. And we found that, in addition to providing the capital that was needed for our business, they were also contributing a lot through the thought partnership that they brought to the table. Because as significant investors, we felt there was complete alignment of interest between their goals and our goals, both of which was to make our business succeed, to make it more valuable, and see how it could become more sustainable. And therefore, having the ability to partner with funds, not just on the capital level, but also on the thought partnership, strategic thinking, they played an important role in helping us build our management team. In the early stages, they were very instrumental in helping us actually execute those M&As, both the M&As we had done, because in our background, we had never done any international acquisition. Both the acquisitions we did, acquiring a firm in Israel and then buying a business out of U.S. bankruptcy court, both were fairly intricate transactions. And therefore, having our partners really work closely with us to execute those was very, very important part of our success. Yeah.
I want to dwell on those two acquisitions that you mentioned. Before you chose them, you must have screened a lot more how did you choose those? And what was it that you decided to let go of when, said that this is something that we don't want to do or this is something that we want to do?
So, at the time we did these two acquisitions, I don't think that we really screened a lot of acquisitions. These were businesses we knew well, had known for a period of time, and we felt that they had fit well in the platform we were looking to build. And therefore, we were more opportunistic when these opportunities came about. But having said that, over the years, we did look at many other acquisitions, and there we did apply filters which led to us not doing some of the other acquisitions. And in my opinion, and I would also say that in the sector of the market we were working, it's a niche business, the off-highway tire business. So there are a finite number of market opportunities or acquisition opportunities available. And therefore, it was hard for us to really, do a lot of strategic thinking around, okay, these are 10 firms, which one do I want to buy? It was, opportunistic. This is there. Does it add value? Yes or no? But along the way, there were other such opportunities that came up, which we felt did not add value, and therefore we passed on it. I think some of the criteria that you have to use is that, in my opinion, you have to do M&A not just for size alone, but any acquisition has to add strategic value to the business you already have in place. You have to feel comfortable on the ability to culturally integrate the firm that you are acquiring. You have to make sure you are taking on a calculated financial risk. If you will go out there and buy something that is much beyond your ability, And, you know, in any acquisition, some things will go right and several things will go wrong. So you have to have the ability to kind of ride through that pain. And therefore, you have to be careful about the size of company you're looking to acquire relative to the capital available with you. So I think these are some of the filters. And there have been opportunities where acquisitions did come up and we weren't convinced on either the, you know, we felt they would add scale but not necessarily strategic value, or we felt that the risk involved in the business integration would be far more than the potential upsides, and, you know, on things like that, we have chosen to walk away from a fair number of acquisitions. So I think you need to know why and what you're looking to acquire, and you need to be disciplined about it.
Would you have a checklist for promoters, for instance, on what they need to look at when they are trying to scale a business?
You know, I think that a checklist is, you know, maybe a little presumptuous on my part, but I would say that any entrepreneur looking to scale a business needs to make sure that there are a few building blocks they have addressed. You know, one is making sure that you have understood and convinced yourself on the fundamental scalability of that model in an economically sustainable manner. You know, yes, it's fine to justify losses for a period of time while you're building the business, but I see a lot of businesses today whose business model seems to be to burn cash, right? And, you know, I don't believe that's sustainable in any way, shape, or form. So I think it's important that firstly, as an entrepreneur, you need to be convinced that you have a business model that is scalable in a very sustainable and profitable manner. I think the second thing that you need to put in place is, or need to think hard about, is the management team. You know, I think my own journey, I have learned that having a strong management team to support you and to complement your own skill sets is very, very important and critical. Thinking about the capital that you will need as you scale is also an important part of the journey. I mean, a lot of people I've seen with good ideas and a lot of talent, because they're you know, not raising capital at the right time or in the right amounts, eventually when they hit a road bump, you know, are not able to sustain. So I think thinking about your capital strategy is very important. And I would say that making sure that you have good advice available to you, because as an entrepreneur, you know, at times you become so business focused, which is very important in building the business, that sometimes you can miss the larger picture, and therefore having you know, good advisors available to advise you, to be thought partners, I would say that is another very important journey as you think to scale.
The reason I asked that was, as an entrepreneur, you have other folks in the network reaching out to you for advice.
Sure.
And what are the things that you hear from them? What is it that they want to know?
You know, I think a few... a few recurring themes that I hear when people reach out for advice is, the largest theme I would say is people issues. You know, how do we think of our team? When do we build the team? You know, a lot of people are you know, making important hires, and you know, sometimes many times they're nervous about that, especially if it's the first important hires they're making. So I think people issues, how to hire, how to motivate, how to retain, that seems to be one consistent sort of area where entrepreneurs you know, need help. And I think the other consistent area is around you know, I think they need, especially if they're first-time entrepreneurs, they need a little bit more reassurance on taking some leap of faiths, you know, which when you build a business, you have to take some leap of faiths and there are risks involved. So I think these are the two recurring things that come up. Other things that come up would be around relationships with investors, and sometimes they can be contentious, sometimes not, things like that.
Very helpful. I actually wanted to move on to the next bit, which is about your personal investments. You have a family office as well.
Sure.
And can you talk a little bit about the investments that you've made from your family office and whether you're looking at making similar investments?
Sure. So, generally, our family office has tended to invest in public market type of instruments, whether it's debt or equity. But we have made a couple of private market investments, one in an e-commerce firm, Nykaa FSN e-commerce, and the other in a financial services firm, Avendus. I think one of the key drivers in making both of these investments were we felt these were areas that are becoming important, e-commerce and the whole digital space on the one hand and financial services on the other hand. That they're becoming a larger part of the Indian economy and will be important for the future. But these are sectors we would not go about and, we had no skill set to build businesses in these areas. So I thought it was good to invest in these businesses because, and I sit on board of both of these companies, because it gives a good ringside view of how these important sectors are developing. Also, these are companies that are going through their own high growth phases. So it's where I felt I could add value to the entrepreneurs, and these entrepreneurs I'd known over several years and had a lot of respect for. It just seemed like a good set of circumstances. We've also invested in several private equity firms. Because that's an area that we find interesting. But we're not proactively looking at new private market investments. But if, something comes along that meets a lot of the boxes I spoke about, we'd be, selectively considering those.
Are there any interesting themes from, say, Nykaa and Avendus that you feel you could apply to your business?
Oh, yeah. Look, one thing that was a big learning for me is no matter what the sector, the growth challenges are always the same, around those three or four buckets that I spoke to you about. I think there are always learnings that one is applying all the time to our own business. From Nykaa, I see a lot how digital marketing, digital communication and digital first thinking is becoming more and more important. And that's something we are certainly thinking how we would apply in our businesses. From Avendus, it's a lot more about learning about governance, which in financial service firms is very key and core. And, how to use those learnings to build on the governance practices we already follow.
By way of conclusion, if you can kind of give us a sense of I know you're bullish on manufacturing, so what are the themes within the space, and maybe not related to the tire business, but what are the other themes and blank spaces you see within manufacturing where there are a lot of opportunities for people?
Yeah, so look, I'm absolutely convinced that manufacturing, India is very strongly placed on this for the next, many decades to come. Look, I think we have the largest population in the world. We have a very, very young population. Which is one of the prerequisites for building a strong manufacturing base, because manufacturing tends to be labor intensive. I think we have, on the infrastructure side, on the energy side today, I think a lot of work has happened over the last decades, where today, if you locate your plant well, you enjoy globally competitive access to utilities and logistics. So given that, I'm absolutely convinced about the future of manufacturing in India. I think the one thing where India still has a disadvantage is the cost of capital in India is much higher than global standards. So I think businesses that are more bespoke in nature and not requiring large amounts of capital where you can deploy India's engineering resources, you can deploy the workforce. And of course, every business needs capital, but if it's not something hugely capital intensive like chips or LEDs or stuff like that, I think in that type of bespoke customized manufacturing, India has a huge future, and there are such opportunities in a large number of sectors.
Thank you so much again, Mr. Mahansaria.
My pleasure.
Thank you for listening.